thanks for coming. We're going to get started with the nice program with the final set of events for LALISA on the second day of the conference. Thanks everyone for coming. I'm so happy to see so many familiar faces and new faces, and faces from LALISA Reed, and faces from, I'm sure, LALISA and Lewis and Clark coming up next year. Thanks for being here, for the support, for the participation, the engagement has been incredible so far. I've been really enjoying the conversations and to see that the programming is not just names on a paper, but a lot of actual thinking and wonderful intellectual work. Tonight we have the pleasure and the honor of having one of our three keynote speakers, who's actually the author of the subtitle of the conference. As you've probably noticed, the concept of the underside of modernity is a concept that has intrigued many of us for quite a while. Professor Dussel has conceptualized modernity over many years, and he's going to be talking about that today. But before we introduce Professor Dussel, I want to make two more announcements about LALISA. I have tickets here for the 8 o'clock play. It's going to be Attic Prop Street Theater in the setting of a cabaret theater at the EMU, our local student union, at the Redwood Auditorium. And I'm going to leave them on this table, so at the end of the conference you can just pick up at least one per person. If you don't yet have yours, make it to the EMU at 8. It's going to be amazing. Teatro Milagro, playing El Payaso, the clown, putting together Nicaragua with the water crisis in Flint, Michigan. Go figure. I'm going to introduce, this is going to be a bit like a Russian doll setup. I'm going to introduce the introducer to tonight's speaker. And the introducer to tonight's speaker is one of our most stellar Latin Americanists on campus. He is the editor of several books and author of several monographs, but among them, Ethics of Liberation in English. Dussel is available in English thanks to our guest introducer, who also helped us really bring Professor Dussel from Mexico. And that's Alejandro Vallega, one of our most recent acquisitions for the Latin American Studies core faculty across campus. He's an associate professor in the Department of Philosophy. He's been recently elected to become the president of the North American Society of Philosophical Hermeneutics, and is now the coordinator for the U.S. of the Sociedad de Filosofía y Liberación. I'm going to just leave you now with him. We will be marching off to the EMU to have dinner, for those of you who signed up, exactly at 6:25. Thank you.
Thank you. This is really an honor to be here today. Thank you, Pedro, and thank you to everyone that has made this amazing effort to bring this to campus. Now, the person I'm going to introduce to you, Professor Dussel, is really, to me, a major inspiration of my work. As to say, somebody who has taught me very much in the last 20 years since I met him here. Before I had come here, I actually met him here at the library, at the lecture room at the library. Paul Celan wrote the following lines: "Die Welt ist voll, ich muss dich tragen. The world has receded from me, comma, I must carry you." Now, the comma here between "the world has receded from me" and "I must carry you," the comma is the crucial point, because there is a question there, right? The comma is an in-between mark, right? And a mark that perhaps indicates the profound crisis, the time of decision in our time. How to carry on the face of the present, on the face of ecological disaster, the impending ruin of the earth, on the face of political turns worldwide that betray democracy, when diversity is betrayed by the very institutions that claim to uphold rights and humanity, when greed, indifference, and rampant individualism betray our best intentions. How do we go on and carry the excluded, the marginalized, those victims and abandoned people? Those histories and ways of being exterminated and if not totally, certainly forgotten, ignored, dismissed. How will we carry our histories and lives in a manner that may make possible futures in a pluriversal world? Our guest this evening has opened the path for taking up this task with the excluded and the forgotten. In his words, one finds ways of bearing and carrying on without neglecting difficulty, without giving up clarity and compassion. I find his work to be not only significant at many different levels, at every level of the discipline and beyond the discipline, but also I find that at least one or two of his works are some of the major works in the history of philosophy in the 20th century. Here's how Professor Dussel concludes an essay on the change, the transformation of philosophy. He writes, "For a long time, perhaps for centuries, the many diverse philosophical traditions will each continue to follow their own path, but nonetheless, a global analogical project, a transmodern pluriversal, pluriverse, other than universal, right? A transmodern pluriversal moment appears on the horizon. Now, other philosophies are possible because another world is possible. And as is proclaimed," he said, "by the Zapatista Liberation Movement in Chiapas, Mexico." So many of us have so quickly forgotten about that movement. Now, Enrique Dussel was born in 1934 in La Paz, in Mendoza, Argentina, actually 3 hours from where I grew up. He first went to Mexico in 1975 as a political exile, and he then became a Mexican citizen. He went to Mexico after having to escape from Argentina, where a paramilitary group had placed a bomb in his house. His house was bombed, and that what pushed him out into Mexico. Now, Professor Dussel teaches in the Department of Philosophy of the Universidad Autónoma Metropolitana, and also in the Universidad Nacional Autónoma de México, which is the UNAM. Right? Now, he has a doctorate from the Complutense University of Madrid, also a doctorate in history from the Sorbonne in Paris, and also a degree in theology that he obtained between Paris and Münster. He has been awarded doctorate honoris causa from the University of Fribourg in Switzerland, the University of San Andrés in Bolivia, the University of Buenos Aires in Argentina, the University of Santo Tomás de Aquino in Colombia, and the National University of General San Martín in Argentina. He is, without any doubt, the most important philosopher of liberation in the history of philosophy of liberation. He was one of the founders, and really he has been the one voice that has, I think, significantly extended to engage not just Latin America or a project of liberation, but has engaged world philosophies. So he's really a part, I think, the reason why I think that his work is so important is that he really has made world philosophies possible, a South-South dialogue, as he calls it himself. Now, he's the author of more than 50 books. So I'll just read a few titles for you that have come out in English. Ethics of Liberation in the Age of Globalization and Exclusion, this is 2013. Politics of Liberation. I have a week all here, all 50. 20 Theses of Politics. Beyond Philosophy, History, Marxism, and Liberation Theology, Philosophy of Liberation, Towards an Unknown Marx, a commentary on the manuscripts of 1861 and to 1963, The Underside of Modernity, Apple, Rorty, Taylor, and the Philosophy of Liberation, The Invention of the Americas, Eclipse of the Other, and the Myth of Modernity. Please join me in welcoming Professor Enrique Dussel.
versus all. I must say always, I don't speak English. I speak something like English, and I call it Spanish. And I hope that you understand. And because I speak so simple English, I speak other languages, but not English, because I never studied in an Anglo-Saxon university. I use very much the blackboard to, like said Charles Peirce, the diagram is part of the concept. I am very happy to be here, and especially with the title of this Congress, because it's the Peripheral Mapping, Social Cultural Geographies from the Underside of Modernity. That's exactly what the title of my book, The Underside of Modernity. The Underside of Modernity is like the other side of the moon. I see always the moon, but the other side I never see, and it's there, and it's not the part that I see. That cannot exist without the other part. That is our problem. That was my problem after to be in Europe 10 years. I began in Spain, 2 years in Israel, quite Semitic world, I will explain, Germany and France. And when I come back to Argentina, my first lecture as university professor was Latin American in the world history. And I wrote this text like the German professors, and I published some years ago, not in the 66, that I exposed this question. For me was a problem that Latin America was out of history. And if you see the vision of Hegel, and I begin to use the blackboard. For Hegel, and for us in general, the world history begin, he said, in Asia, but it's the childhood time in China. Because it begin in China, and after go to India, and go to Persia, that is Iran today, and after the Hellenistic world and the Roman Empire. And that is the antiquity. And after come the Middle Age, is the age that's in the middle. Middle Age. And modernity. And that is the vision that we have for the world history. But not only you. I studied this history in the high school, in the university. And I was almost in all the world. I teach in China, in India, in Pakistan, in Nairobi, in Berlin, in Harvard, in all places. All people in the world and all universities use this periodization of the world history. And always in all my hundreds of lectures, always I ask, one of you learn history with other periodization? Say to me that you studied in other periodization. And never in Africa, Asia, Latin America, say, I studied the history with other periodization. And I ask, when we begin to use this periodization, which is the history of this geographical and historical mapping, that is the subject, and the people don't know very much, are only 2 centuries, are the romantics, Schlegel, Schiller, Novalis. And Novalis said in a text that Walter Benjamin put, contained in the dissertation of the concept of reflection and criticism in the Romantic period, Novalis said, we invented the antiquity. How is it possible that a group of persons can invent it, a period of history? Yes, before the Romantic, nobody thought in this periodization. And now it's worldly, all the world. That is a small example of the Eurocentric vision of all human social science. It's a construction, ideological construction, and not before Hegel has a complete vision of things. Hegel was died in 1831, and Hegel is the first philosopher, not in Berlin, that made the construction of all his lectures in history, the aesthetic, the history of philosophy, the history of culture, the right. All the courses of Hegel's is in history, and it's this history, is the first conceptualization that he said, Europe is der Sylt und der Zentrum der Weltgeschichte. Europe is the goal and the center of the world history. Pretension, claim. And second, he said that the realization of Europe is the realization of the human geist, the spirit of the world, and especially Germany, but not Germany, the north of Europe, Germany, Denmark, and England, north of Europe, and not the south of Europe. The south of Europe is out of history. And we, Latin America, that was a colony of this south of Europe. They are not in the history. The vision of Hegel on Africa. He said Africa is a primitiveness, there's so much people. There is no Christ, there is no spirit. You must see. And we, America, or North America, are the future. Without past, we have no past. It's fantastic. So for me, I say, that is a problem. But who I am? And that was my obsession, my 10 years in Europe, and it's my obsession from the 57 of the last century until today. It's the unique subject that is thought in my life. What means to be a Latin American is very complex, because from the father part, my father, meeting cultural, come from the West. It can be Cortes, the father. But Cortes means all the history of the Eurasia. I will show you. And Spain is the west part of the Western culture. And my mother, that is like Guatlicue or Guadalupe, Carlos Fuentes said, that is an Indian, an American culture, is the extreme east of the extreme east. Because all Indians, all, come from Asia. And that means that the mother is here and cross-bearing to America. That means is here. And from Spain, from the West. And this shock is exactly Latin America. To explain Latin America, you need to explain the world history. But the other side of the world history, because we are not. What meaning? So my first question was the question of the beginning of philosophy. Not the world philosophy, only the Greek philosophy. Because Herodotus, Plato, and Aristotle, they say our philosophy comes from Egypt. But the Europeans said the philosophy comes from Greece. Don't read the Greek people. But Parmenides said the being is, and the non-being is not. And for a normal person, said, what means that? It's stupid. It's obvious what you speak. The being is. The non-being is not. What means this negativity is this positive, the being. And that's beginning all. Because the being is the Greek people. And the non-being, what is? Heraclitus said very clearly. Heraclitus of Ephesus. Because I was in Ephesus because there were a World Congress in philosophy in Istanbul to Turkey. And we were in Ephesus and many other countries. Cities in the Turkey. I was in Ephesus, a big city with the mountains. And the mountains, I said, what is there? And after I saw a map, what was the wall of Ephesus? Heraclitus said, the logos arrive until the wall. Interesting for today that we will do the wall. Until after the wall, he said in Greek, at the hoi poloi. The hoi poloi means the many. The barbarian. That is the key question. The being is Greece. The non-being is the barbarian. And it's very clear. Aristotle said the anthropos, the human being, is the living being, and we translate political. No, that is an ideological translation. Politikos means that a bit is alive in the polis, in the Greek polis. The human being is a living being that is in the polis. But the other cultures, they are not polis. That is the barbarian, and not human. And for Aristotle, the Macedonian, that was the Europeans, or Europa, is a Greek name. And they put this name for the barbarian of the Serbia, more or less today. That means Greece was not Europe, and Europe was the barbarian of the time of the Greek. But after the Europeans, believes that the Europe is the origin of Europe. The Greeks can say, I have nothing to do with Europe. You are the barbarian in the history of the real. And I said, that is exactly the question. I am not, because I am a Latin American. I am not a historian, I am not a human, for the president of the United States today. I am not human because I am in the other part of the world, and because that I need to be the world to show. That means it's an ontology of domination. And we read that in the 60s, 68. You remember Marcuse, Herbert Marcuse, the one-dimensional man. The one-dimensionality is the being, and the non-being is not. And we are the non-being for Europe. That begins the question. And exactly that is the philosophical position of Emmanuel Levinas. Levinas was the first phenomenologist philosopher in France, Jewish. And I was in Israel too. I learned Hebrew. I write Hebrew. I read Hebrew. I am not Jewish. I am Latin American. But I am Semit, because I need to make a reconstruction of all this history to know who is Cortes. And I need to do the other history of the extreme East to know which is my mother Indian. And it's a reconstruction of the world history. And in the reconstruction of the Eurasia history, I cannot be Eurocentric, but the question of Eurocentrism, there is other centrism before. Because the Eurocentrism inspired, the inspiration is from the Greece. The origin of the European civilization is Greece. And that means we make the construction of one Hellenocentric vision of the world history. It's a pure invention, because Greece was not the origin of the cultures in the Middle East. The Mediterranean Sea. If you see the Mediterranean, I go very quickly. here is Turkey, here is the Nile, here is the Euphrates and Tigris, the Mesopotamia. I will speak. And after here, we have Greece and Italy. This Greece, for example, speak on the logos, the reason logos. But as a big people that the Jewish, it speak too on logos, but the logos is the word in Hebrew, that bar. You know Hebrew, that is the modern Hebrew. Is not the classic. But the logos of Egypt and the Navar of Egypt, the Greece, and the Navar of Jerusalem began in Egypt, because Ptah, the god of Egypt, has the earth, that says Horus, Horus is the affectivity, but Toph is the language. In the language come the logos and the davar. Jerusalem, Athens, is in Tebas. 5,000 years ago, all this history begins in North Africa. But North Africa is very interesting. It's a black civilization. Tutankhamun, in all that, was black because they come from the Bantu civilization. And the mother culture of the Palestinian and the Greek civilization are the Africans. And Hegel speaks that in Africa there is nothing. And that was the beginning of the culture of the Mediterranean Sea. And I needed to criticize this Hellenocentric vision of the Eurocentric, criticize the Greeks from other cultures out of this. And that's what the Semitic world. In the Semitic world, it's very important to understand what happened in the life of my father, Cortes. That was a patriarchal, dominant, machist, and all many things, and violent, because was the inversion of Christianity. Was not a Christian, was the inversion of Christianity. And begin the second inversion with him. I will explain this question. That means I am a Latin American, but I need now be responsible to rethinking all, because we confront a very special situation. And in this case, the most difficult for me is take out all my Eurocentric formation, because I was absolutely Eurocentric. I studied philosophy, 5 years Greek, 5 years Latin. I read Greek, the Aristotle, Plato in Greek. In Latin, I can read Thomas of Aquinas, San Augustine, a classical studies. But the question is, that was the origin of this interpretation of Europe. When I ask in Mexico, one person of people, you know who is Odyssey? Odysseo, Odyssey, the Greek poems. The people say, Odyssey, I don't know. What is Moses? Yes. Why he know who is Moses? Because he is Christian as culture, perhaps as believer. But in this culture, Latin America, Cortes, the Christianity is present. But this Christianity is a Semitic tradition. It's a Semitic tradition that began 5,000 years ago. The last year it was in Morocco, Rabat. I spoke to 300 Islamic research people, University of Rabat. In Latin America, I speak to the Arab Muslim people. As culture, I am a Christian. How I do? Very easy. I begin to speak on Hammurabi, the God of Hammurabi. The God of Hammurabi that was in Babylon, 50 kilometers of Baghdad, where the barbarian of the 21st century destroyed the holy city like Baghdad. Baghdad is together London, Paris, Berlin, and Rome. 500 years was the center of the world history, Baghdad. I remember I knew a professor here in America, North America. I said, you come from Baghdad? Yes, I am Jewish. And your family comes from Baghdad? Yes. And how old was your family? My family was from the 4th century in Baghdad. We are the community disrupt the Mishnah. One Jewish of Baghdad was exiled in the United States. Baghdad, I will speak after, but only the barbarian can put the bomb in a holy land like this. It's like I destroyed Rome, total. The Basilica, the Vatican, all the Roman Empire center, but not only Athens together, because Baghdad as well. And in this Babylon, 3,070 years ago, was Amurabi, and he did a codex of God. And in this codex, he said, I did justice with the poor, with the orphan, with the widow, and the foreigner. I have there all the categories of my philosophy. Because my son is mine, is the being. My wife is my wife. We. The poor is the rich, is one of me, and the citizen is a part of the community. But the orphan is the son of the orphan. In the exteriority is the non-being. The widow is in the non-being because has not a man that defends her, the widow. The orphan, I say, the poor is this that is not rich, that nobody helps him. And the foreigner is not the citizen, but is somebody that is the immigrant. Today, it's interesting. We are in the primitive period of the draw, the law, the school of law. In our law, don't say, I did justice with the foreigner. We are before Hammurabi. The Hammurabi law is more developed than our constitutional law, because said the foreigner is human being like the member of the city. That is the ethics of the Semitics. So I begin to speak of the Babylon that is valid for a Muslim, for a Jew, and for a Christian, because we come from this civilization. And I spoke after of Hammurabi, the book of death of Tebas in Egypt, 5,000 years ago. And you see, Osiris was a god of the resurrection. The myth, the rationality, Osiris. The Osiris asked to the death, when you do good in your life. And in the chapter 125 of the book of the death, the death person said to Osiris, I give food to the hunger. I give water to the thirst. I give a dress to the naked. I ships the ship for the pelagic. Eat, drink, dress. After a year ago, but 20 centuries before us, 33 centuries before Osiris, was exiled in Egypt the founder of Christianity, because it was in Egypt, you remember. And he was in Egypt. And he said the same. The criteria of the last judgment is give food for the hunger, water to the dead, dress for the home, and a house for this house, not house, because in Palestine there is not the Nile, and you not need the sheep. But in this case, you need a house. And you say that is a very material, ethical exigencies. Eat, drink, has a dress, a house. You are a materialist. Yes, Engels, in The Origin of Family, Engels said the four first necessities are eat, drink, rest, and house. Ah, a coincidence between the Egyptian civilization that affirmed the flesh. The founder of Christianity is Matthew 25, an Engels, full marks. That is what materialistic ethic, that means fleshly. That is the flesh of birth. That is the central question. You see, what I say you, I don't know, but you can begin to reflect that many things are different. From this tradition of the Semitic war and the Jewish tradition, 20 years, 20 centuries before, begin a group of a sect of Jewish people, a sect of Jewish people that call himself the Messianic and Messiah. Messiah in Hebrew is a Messiah, is a consecrate. In Greek, it's Christos. And the Messianic people is the Christian Noi. The Christians are the Messianic people. Is the name was again the Roman Empire, because they have a sumo pontifex, the emperor that was the bond between the human beings and the gods. And he said, sumo pontifex is not the emperor, and the emperor is not God, a mass is not God. And this messianic people was atheist of all gods of the Roman Empire. Atheist, and the accusation to be killed in the circus of Rome was they are ateum Romanorum deorum. They are atheist against all gods of the Roman Empire. The atheism is the condition of possibility to change the thing. When the things are sacred, become sacred. And if you are atheist of all, Saint John of Cross said, after all is nothing, but this nothing is the God of the Semites, and can be atheist of all gods, and have a God that is other of all gods, and because of that can be atheist. I say that to you to understand that I begin very quickly to do a criticism of the Greek civilization and philosophy that I studied in the name of the Semitic world. My first book was the Semitic Humanism, 62. And the second, the Hellenistic Humanism, to understand the Indo-European people. But the Indo-European people was the horse iron people that invited China to achieve the alien in Asia. Persia was the Hellenistic, was the Roman, and the German, the Indo-European people. That is the metaphysics of the Greece. But the expansion of the Semites come not from the north, come from the desert. And from there, they go here, the Palestinian and the Phoenician, Lebanon, Babylonian, Jewish, Christian, and Muslim. And I cannot do all the history because I have an absolute different vision of history, of the Eurocentric vision. This book, The Politics of Liberation, A Critical World History, is in English. I thought to do a small introduction in history, 70 pages, and I wrote 700 pages. But it's exactly not a history of politics. I do the anti-history of politics. The history of politics does there is not one historian of politics that wrote that. I take John Locke, the founder of liberalism. But in the second treatise of government, John Locke justified the conquest of Latin America. He justified. Why? Justified the slavery. And he's a racist. But nobody read these chapters. Read other chapters of John Locke. It's the same for Hegel. Hegel said, Europe became more rich, less people, but there is many poor people. What we do with the poor people of Europe, we send it to the colonies. And the poor of Europe come from America and Latin America. My father or my grandfather was a poor German. A socialist. But in 1870. But was a poor. And we say, we receive with hospitality the poor of Europe. And what they do now with the Syrian, with the Iraqi, fantastic history, because if Syria is destroyed, it's because one government in the world said the president of Syria must not be the president, and we will take out. And it's not going to go out, we destroyed Syria. Which is your right to do that? I don't know. Which philosophy can justify this crime that is now? And yesterday I listened, because I am the Congress, that they put a bomb in Afghanistan. It's a criminal act, but that will go slowly. You see, I have another vision of all things, and that is exactly changing the vision of things. And this is that we call the color epistemological decolonization. Because we are colonies, Latin America, Africa. We are colonies, if we are colonies. But though the president of Mexico is a colonial mentality, give all richness of the country to the transnational corporations against the people, is a colonial mentality. But not only the politicians, the science is Eurocentric, the sociology, the politics, the psychoanalysis, is Eurocentric Freud and all the social science are Eurocentric. That means we need an epistemological criticism of this Eurocentrism that constitutes the modern science. And the question is exactly, what is modernity? I give the last three semester the subject, and I am in this semester because Wednesday I have a lecture. I work the question, a new time, modernity. What is modernity? Is it age of the world history? Is it civilization? And many aspects of modernity. And there is a dispute because there is postmodern that are still modern, because they are all European. And so these postmodern are not post, that the last moment of modernity. Many think will be many modernities. Taha Abdul Rahman, a philosopher of Morocco, think that it's possibly in the future many modernities. And I discussed with him, and we sat in discussion. The other thing, the modernity is not in the end, must develop many possibilities, Habermas. And when begin the modernity? Because it's very important to know when begin the modernity. Because in this history, modernity is the end of the Middle Ages. And that means to understand what is Middle Age to understand modernity. Middle Age feudalism has validity only for Europe. There is no other civilization that was feudal and was in Middle Age. In Middle Age. What means, why was Europe in the obscure time? What was in the decadence? What Europe was closed? We don't know, because we have not a non-Eurocentric vision of history. It's very simple, very simple. Europe means the Germanic Latin part of the Roman Empire, not the east part that is Greek, Byzantine. That is another question. So the Europe, that we call Europe, and America is the development of Europe. There is no novelty, there is a development. Europe, with 70 million persons in the Middle Ages, China has more than 150 million in the same time. This Europe was close with a war. The war, in the end, was the Ottoman Empire. But from the 711, that Tariq came from Africa and invaded Spain and arrived until Poitiers in the 736, 150 kilometers from Paris. The Arabs, if Tariq arrived to Paris, and speak now in Arab. In Arab, not in Spanish or England, in Arab, because all Europe had been occupied with the Arab. But Carlos Martel, Charles, stopped the Arabs and then begin to go out. But what was the Arabic world? They were in the Califato of Cordoba, Morocco, Spain. One fantastic Califato. In Cordoba, we have Averroes, the most important Aristotelician after Aristotle, Maimonides, the theologian of the Jewish civilization, was in Cordoba, and after was in Fez, or today Morocco, Fez. Fez, in the 9th century, was a university, it was with 1,000 students. Cordoba was the most important in the time, but as in the beginning, because after we have Egypt with the Fatimids, El Cairo, a big civilization, and we have the Caliphate of Baghdad that was founded in 752 until the 1270. 500 years, Baghdad was the center of the Eurasian world. Arrived to Cairo, to Istanbul, that was here, through Kabul, arrived to India, and after come other kingdoms, the Mughal in India, after in southwest of Asia, until Philippines. I gave a course in Negros, in Philippines, in an airplane arrived in the airport in the island Mindanao. And I saw the woman with the hijab, and mosques. I said, I am in the Pacific. That is like Baroque. In 1492, the Islamic world was from Atlantic to Pacific, and all the canals was Muslims. The only universal civilization in the Middle Age, feudal obscurantism, was the Islamic world. That was not feudal, was absolute urban, was mercantile, because the caravans from here arrived to China, they arrived to India. Marco Polo, one Venetian, arrived in China. One person. And all here are hundreds of caravans with 1,000 camels that go from Baghdad to China. And in this moment, in the 8th century, 10th century, in the wisdom house of Baghdad, was the most important mathematician of the world. And we have the Arabic numbers. From where? From Arabs. And algebra is a chapter of mathematics? No. It's the name of a mathematician of Baghdad. They knew that the sun was the center of the system, was the most developed civilization in the world, because the west part of the Roman Empire, Byzantine, Greek, is not Europe. Teach to the Arabs and translate Aristotle, the Greek, to the Arabs. Where? Alchemy. Where? In Aleppo. In what year? 860. Aleppo. I read in the newspaper, no? Yeah. That Aleppo is destroyed. A city where was the reception of Aristotle in 9th century? where Europe was in the barbarian, was Europe was underdeveloped, peripheral, and under and out of history, because the Arab put the world. That is the expression. But we don't know nothing on the history of the Arabs, the philosophy, the literature, the fantastic. Our ignorance. We know only the Greek, the Roman, Middle Age, Europe. That is 10% of the history of the humanity. And we believe that we are very cultivated. It's when, if you go to one of these countries, you can begin to understand many things. This Europe was in the world. The closest they go here to take contact with the sisters of the Arab peoples, and they come back. Europe cannot go out. But there is only one place to go out of this world. It's the Atlantic Ocean. It's the Atlantic Ocean, not the Mediterranean Sea, that Hegel said is the center of the world history. The Mediterranean is a small sea. Here we have the Arabic, the sea, and the Chinese sea. But the Mediterranean was a small, but now it's open to the Atlantic. The Brodel had a big move on the Atlantic in the time of Philip II. But Pierre Chonin was my professor in Sorbonne. He wrote 7 volumes, Seville and Atlantic. And Spain opened Europe to the Atlantic. And this opening to the Atlantic is now the contact with all the world through the oceans. And that is the beginning of modernity. They go out of the feudal time and the Middle Age. But in this moment, the Arab countries never was in the Middle Age, but begin the decadence. When I go to the Arab world and I say to the intellectuals, why is the decadence in 16th century of the Arab civilization? They don't know. They don't know because the elites are Eurocentric. And they don't know the history of the Arab world. They don't see the relation between Latin America and the Arab world. You say, and nothing to do. It's interesting. I was in the island, say, in Syria, in Italy. Italy is Sicilia. But here was the battle of Lepanto, where the Spanish people destroyed the army of the Turkey. But I saw the date, 1571. I said, oh, it's clear. It's a very clear. Why? If you take 25 years, you have other date. It's 1546. Ah, 1646. What happened in 1466? I read in the archive of in Sevilla in India in my thesis of history in Sorbonne. The first bishop Catholic of Bolivia wrote to the king in 1550. 4 years ago, the Spanish people discovered a mouth of the Ebro that they immortal grand quantity of human being to the argot is the mind with the name Potosi. The main Potosi was discovered 25 years after the Panto. And what are to do? From Potosi, the Spanish people took more than 20,000 tons of silver. That produced a devaluation of the silver in all the world. And the Arabs became poor without loose money, because the silver has less value. And the Latin America was the origin of the crisis on all the world, Arab. Never they thought, because they think Arab world, Europe. It never thought in Latin America. That is the relation. When I have a vision of the world history, I understand that the Spanish had money to pay a big army to destroy the target. And they took that from Latin America. Because before the Pelvis, before there is 1.5 century of the very important history of Latin America, because was the origin of modernity. That is the question. The hypothesis is that the modernity is not the invention of Europe and the creativity of all of Europe. No, it's a face-to-face. It's the modernity, but in the definition of modernity, we have coloniality. Because the modernity arrived in America. And we read some months ago in my lectures in UNAM sobre modernity, the text of Bartolomé de las Casas, the arriving of Columbus at Bahamas, the 11 October in the night, she saw the people fire in that one island, say, how help? So the 12th October, 1492, they arrived to the island. That is exactly the place and the date of the beginning of modernity. They saw the Indians, and Bartolomé said, like these people were 6 hours after Adam and Eve. 6 was absolute naked. Naked. They saw these new gods that arrived in the ocean. Sympathetic. Often, she saw these people very good. This was the first contact of one European with an absolute unknown world. For Columbus was Asia. And Columbus died, and he didn't discover America. He was always, until the fourth trip in America, in Asia, always. When he arrived in Panama, he wrote in the journal of the capital, Panama, they say there is a sea in the other side. He put the South Sea. We are 10 days of navigation to the Ganges. Because for Colón, there were in Asia 4 peninsulas, and we have the map. Was the peninsula Arabic, India, Southern Asia, and a peninsula in the south of China. That was a map of the Chinese. But the Venice, Venedics, do a mistake and put South America in the south of China. And in this case, Columbus had this map. Enricus Martellus in 1487 designed this map. So Columbus arrived here. He said, I am near of the king of the great Khan, the Khanatos, was a Chinese king for Columbus. He was in Bahamas, and he believed that was in China. And after when he arrived to the Orinoco River, fantastic, he said, from where comes so much water? Because he believed that was on the peninsula. And she said, are the law of the paradise. It's a fantastic law of Columbus. Americo Vespucci was in the peninsula and go to the south. He arrived to Ecuador. He arrived until Patagonia, in South Argentina. He said, it's a new world. America? No. The peninsula was bigger than they believed. And that is a new world, but it's not America, it's Asia. And in the 1506, Valdez Müller do a map. Fantastic. Because he do it with the peninsula in the south of China, the Southeast Asia, with India, with Arabia, with all Africa, with Mediterranean. This year, and he designed in the other part of the Atlantic, North America and South America without the intim of Panama. But he designed the coast of the Atlantic very clear and the Pacific perfectly designed in the year that never of Europe arrived until the Magellan Strait and it designed from where? From China. The Chinese discovered America 1 century before the Europeans. The Chinese discovered the paper in the 4th century, discovered the printing machine in the 8th century, printing paper money in the 9th century, 1,000 years before Europe. And the professor Tulmin is very known in the book Cosmopolis. I must to say, show his ignorance. He wrote this book, this text. Some people, the origin of modernity in the year 1436 with Gutenberg adoption of the printing machine. He didn't know that the Chinese discovered 8 centuries before Gutenberg the printing machine. The Turmin professor, very important in the United States, the Eurocentric, like all others. And after he said, perhaps can be 1520 with Luther rebellion against the church. Was not 1520, was 1517. If we celebrate this year the 500 years of the 95 thesis of Luther and Wittenberg, 500 years of the Reformation we celebrate here. Philike was other questions, and not put the discovery of America that is Eurocentric definition. Discovery of America, no, invasion of America, because the people that was here didn't discover America. Hegel said, and the human being discovered America. That's, the human being is Europe. So the origin of modernity is exactly this arriving. And that is the subject of my talk. That was one introduction. Because you see, I cannot speak without beginning the destruction of all tradition. Because in this case, you know all, and all that I say is ununderstandable. And the philosophers in the United States, and the analytical, special, the circle of Vienna, Carnap, all these people that has the control of the philosophical department in the United States, that do not philosophy, but only a formal description of the language that is a means to do philosophy. Philosophy, language, logic, formalism, they don't touch any real question. It's a problem. The question is now situate this question. When begin not the modernity, that for me is clear, is 1492, because it's the moment of where Europe is out of the block of the Arabs, it begin to develop in all the world, but a moment. Jacques Goody wrote a beautiful book, The Theft, the Steal of History. And Jacques Goody is a professor in Cambridge, England, but was 10 years in Africa, and he wrote this book that the Europeans steal the history. That means they take information of all cultures, because they touch America, but Africa, India, China. They take information. Like when I read my in the computer an archive and I study. And after that I study, I close the archive, and I am the author of the content. And not only after I speak against the barbarian of this origin of my information. China began the Industrial Revolution before England. Now it's known, and you have the big book, 50 volumes of Nietzsche. The history of science and technology in China. Leonardo da Vinci has many inventions, the machines, the parachutes, fantastic. Leonardo, he was an inventor. In 1313, the Chinese do an printing in paper encyclopedia of technology. And Menzies took photos of this encyclopedia of technology of the Chinese. He put in front of each Chinese publisher put the design of Leonardo. Leonardo only copied all the designs of the Encyclopedia of China. Didn't invent nothing. The China is not a miracle. It's a coming back. They were in technology much more developed of Europe in many centuries. They put the first anthropologists of steel in England and Schiffer, Chinese engineers in the 18th century. And they was more developed until the end of the 18th century. Beginning in the 19th century, Europe couldn't sell China nothing. Only buy with the silver of America. They sell the textile in seda, sorry.
Silk.
Or the china, that was the instrument to read, to eat in all the aristocratic families in the world, in Africa, in Asia, in all places. The content of the world market was here Chinese until 1830. 1830. China produced more steel than the United States and Europe together until 1830. That is Gunder Frank studying this question. And for that, it's necessary now take seriously what happened in philosophy. We say that philosophy begins in modernity with Descartes, with the discourse, de la method. 1637. And the beginning of modernity was almost 1.5 centuries before. There were no philosophy, yes. It was the scholastic. And the scholastic feudal. No. The scholastic used the methodology of exposition of the Arab and the Middle Age civilization. But the content in 16th century is absolute modern. And more than that, I speak on the first anti-discourse of modernity. That means not only a philosopher that knew philosophy, but was the first that criticized the origin itself of the modernity in the moment of the modern that began. That was in 1514 until 1566. And this person was Bartolomé de las Casas. And we can situate the question. He was born in Sevilla in the Middle Age. 1484, Middle Age, because was close to Europe. With 17 years old, he was in Santo Domingo and Cuba, soldier of Velázquez. With 1510, he was called, his consciousness, to become a Catholic priest. But there were not a bishop. He was in Rome, he was consecrated priest. And he came back to Santo Domingo. He said, I am the first Catholic priest that celebrate the first mass liturgy in this continent in 1510. And he listened in 1511 the criticism of two Dominicans, Pedro de Córdoba and Montesinos, against the conquest of America and the treatment of the Indians. And they used the two Dominicans, a Semitic text in Latin, ego vox clamante in deserto. I am the word that crying in the desert. That is Isaiah in the Palestina, but now it's in the island of Santo Domingo, America. It's 1511. You understand? The pilgrims arrived. When all is ended, when the question is clear. In 16th century, was not the question of ontology, the ego cogito, a foundational moment of the modern ontology. That is a philosophical question, ego cogito. I expose who is Descartes. Because Descartes was in 10 years in a college of philosophy, 1606 until 1616. He studied 10 years from 10 until 20 in a Jesuit school of the Spanish people. That means that the first French philosopher studied with the Jesuit that was Spanish people. And he said the first book that I read in philosophy was La Disputación Metafísica de Suárez, a Jesuit. But the Jesuit that Suárez in Coimbra had 500 students, but the student was in Boa, Asia. In Africa, in Latin America. That means was a professor with a student of all the world. Nobody in France, Germany, England, Italy has this public because only Spain was open. Spain is the first modern state. And the Inquisition, for example, he said, intelligence service. It's not the Middle Age. The Inquisition in the Middle Age was not like the Spanish Inquisition because they exposed the Jewish and the Arabs to have only Catholics, the homogeneity of the modern state. Many things. That means Bartolomé Las Casas listened what said the Dominicans, but he was a priest in Cuba. Interesting. Cuba. In Cuba too begin the story of the anti-discourse of modernity. In Santi Espiritu, a small town, he was there, and you can read the autobiographic description. He said, the priest Bartolomé de las Casas in the history of India, first volume, chapter 78. He was there, and the governor, Velázquez, said to Las Casas, celebrate the mass. He was in the island. He said, this Sunday, Tash, was a text that he need to read to the participants. And was a text of the Ben Sira, the Ecclesiasticus, a text that after Trento was out of the Bible for the Catholics, because the Catholicism is so old like the Lutheran Church, and was founded with the Concilio of Trento, because the Middle Age Church was the Church of the Mediterranean Sea against the Arabs. Thomas of Aquinas write contra gentes, the gentes are the Arabs. But now the Arabs are not the problem. Now we are in the Atlantic. And that is the refoundation of the South and the refoundation of the North of Europe. The North of Europe put separate from the South, the Lutheran, and I give this lecture 3 years ago in Heidelberg, when begin the preparation for the celebration of this year in the Lutheran Church. And I give a lecture to 50 Lutheran theologians from Yale, Harvard, but to Brazil and Germany, in all Germany. I said, without the discovery of America and the openness to Atlantic, Luther had been a secondary Christian. Why? Because the Baltic was absolute close. Europe needed go to Rome to connect it with the Eurasiatic world. But with the Atlantic, the Baltic gives to the new center, geopolitical center, and don't need more the Mediterranean, because it's the death of the Mediterranean, it's the burning of the Atlantic. The Lutheran Church has a world signification because the Atlantic is modern. And the Catholic Church is not the Middle Age Church. It's absolutely diverse. It's modernized. That means rationalized. It's other question. All this is against the history in the Eurocentric vision. The text of Rick Las Casas in 1514 is fantastic. Fantastic. Because he said, in this Sunday fell this text, and he put the text. I read. This text was discovered in the Qumran caves in Hebrew, because he didn't have the Hebrew text. The text said so. It's a critique against the temple in the Israel tradition. To offer in sacrifice that which is stolen from the poor is to kill the child in the presence of the father eyes. Bread is the life of the poor, and whoever takes it away committed murder. To take away the food of one's fellow man is to kill them, to deprive them of a good salary is to spill their blood. When I read this text, I say, wow, it's all Marx.
Yes.
All Marx is fantastic. And it's not only that, it's the economy in a liturgy act. And it's the criticism against the capitalism in the beginning of the mercantile. I think slowly, because it's a fantastic text. He said, offer sacrifice that you stolen to them. Who is killed them? That means Bartolomé de las Casas was a mess. And he had the offer. And he said, oh God, attention with the God. Because in the Guatola is in God we trust. But for the founder of Christianity, the money is Mammon. That means the anti-God. And they put in the money that is God. Which is the capital of the God of the founder of Christianity?
Yeah.
No, it's a mistake. It's God. It's a blaspheme text. Idolatry. If Bartolomé de las Casas understood, listen, offer God a sacrifice. God is here, and I offer you bread. I offer you bread. But this bread, I stole it still to the poor. Second, he said, to take away the food of one fellow is to kill them. To deprive them of the salary is to spill their blood. Speak on salary, young blood, I know much, but it's not my subject. I wrote four values on Marx, one in English. I am of the most recognized Marxist in the world because I am the only that wrote a commentary on the fourth draft of Capital. And I worked in the unpublished text of Marx in a slaughter like in Berlin. Black Marx did. The circulation of value in the capital is blood circulation. You use blood. Why? Because Marx was Jewish. On all categories of Marx as metaphorical, Semitic. And I wrote a book. It now is in translation in Duke University Press. You will read perhaps in the beginning of the next year. The title is The Metaphorical Theology of Marx. The Marxist said, what is that? And the Christian said, what is that? It's Marx. I say it's of Capital, not of the God of Israel. And from there, I criticize the Marxist-Leninism, but I can do a critique against the Capital. But here, a text that is 22,000 years ago, we have the same categories. He said, deprive them the salary is spill blood. It's exactly the question of Marx. The surplus value is the non-paid part of the labor of the worker in the salary question. Until the salary is paid, when I take part of the objectification of the human life a value and don't pay, I spill blood. And when I say to God, I offer you this bread, fruit of labor on the earth, but the bread is the objectification of the human life, because the value, said Marx, is the objectification of the human life. That means I say to God, receive the life of the poor to celebrate. In this case, this God needs the life of the poor. It's not God, it's a fetish. Because drink water. And he saw the Bartolomé de las Casas, in confirmation of which everything he read, he found favorable, and he was accustomed to say and affirm. No, the other. He began to consider the misery and servitude of those people, the Indians, applying the one, the text Semit, to the other, the reality in the Caribbean. He determined within himself, convinced of the truth that all that in this Indies was committed toward the Indian was unjust and tyrannical. That is the criticism of modernity in the beginning. Or today I can say exactly the same, but multiplied 1,000 times. That is the critique. But it's more, he said to the governor, I have cannot celebrate the liturgy. Because he discovered that the bread was still to the poor, that is a murder. So he has not to offer nothing to God, because what the system of encomienda, the Indians was encomendado to him and worked without salary for the Spanish people. He was one of them. So he has not more bread, because he related the Indian and the bread. And this, in the Catholic words, or también in the Anglican or Presbyterian or the Christian, is the liturgy, the Eucharistic. But the interesting is the relation between the Eucharistic as liturgy with the economics. And that is a new type of thinking. That is our thinking in Latin America. That is the philosophy of liberation. We say, you believe in God, in the idol, because the idol you believe, not a God of Israel, the God of the poor. That means the God of Syria, the God of Afghanistan, the God of Iraq, the God of Libya. We destroy countries, millions of persons. For what? For the oil. That is the capital. And that was in the 1850, the first bishop in Bolivia said, we more grand quantity of Indians to the new God, the silver. That means the capital. I am not very short. I needed a semester. I will only finish with the tradition of the human sacrifices is not irrational for the natural law, because they don't know the revelation. Natural reason said to God, we need to give the best. And the best is the human being, irrational. He justified the possibility of the Adam to immolate human beings to the gods. I need to convince them that is not necessary. But if I don't convince them, I cannot oblige. And they have right to defend his truth with weapons. And this is a just war until the last judgment. He said, I have consciousness that I am the first that said this.
I'm sorry, we're going to have to stop because we have to go to dinner and we're already 25 minutes late.
Thank you.
And Professor Dussel is going to be with us all day tomorrow too, if you want to talk with him, if you want to ask him, and we hope to actually have him at some point for that full term.